You know, as the book says, it is Canada in Africa. I am an African from Eritrea, a Northeast African nation, which gained independence not too long ago, in 1993. And I am an African who lives in Canada. And actually, I should say before I go on, that I would like to acknowledge that we are on unceded Coast Salish territories, on the lands of the Musqueam, Squamish, and Tsleil-Waututh nations. And I think this is a necessary acknowledgement always, but I think it's particularly necessary today in light of what we are talking about. So as I said, I'm from Eritrea. And I have a feeling that everyone here knows about the current refugee crisis. In the last 15 years, roughly, something like 25,000 people have drowned in the Mediterranean. And the Mediterranean is just one of the many routes that people are taking to find salvation and seek liberation. There has, recently we saw the photo of Alan Kurdi, the three-year-old Syrian boy, face down in the sand. Syrians are the number one group crossing the Mediterranean, and it's very important to recognize that and talk about the current Syrian crisis. But I think there has been a one problem is that we haven't talked about the many African nations which are producing refugees crossing the Mediterranean, for one. One of those countries is Eritrea. Eritrea is, depending on the statistics you look at, either number two or number three in terms of nations producing refugees and crossing the Mediterranean and drowning in the Mediterranean. There are lots of harrowing details about the journey. People crossing the border, walking over the border from Eritrea into the Sudan, getting picked up by traffickers, 30 or so people cramped into a truck, people dying of dehydration or of starvation, people reaching Libya, and rather than being put onto boats immediately and sent over to Italy or Greece or wherever, they are put into detention centers, holding centers, and face torture, hunger. Many are shot and many die. They are held ransom. I know people in my own extended family, who've gotten phone calls from Eritreans, cousins, nieces, nephews, asking for tens of thousands of dollars. And if they don't get that money, we don't know exactly what's going to happen to them, but it's going to be something terrible. They're on boats, rickety boats, for days without food and water. When they reach Europe, who knows what happens to them? They're reaching a continent that is not interested in taking in refugees right now. It's an incredibly terrible situation. And I read something not too long ago about, even those boats that make it to Europe, there's something called, I think it's called a mixed boat, where on the top of the boat, they've got the Syrian refugees, and at the bottom, they've got the African refugees. Because the idea is that if anyone finds them, they are more likely to help those boats that seem to have white or light-skinned passengers. And when those boats capsize, I think we know who are more likely to drown. It's gonna be the people at the bottom. It's gonna be the Africans. It's gonna be Eritreans, people I know. So this is the current situation. This is where we've been for a decade and a half, if not more. And what I wanted to say in relation to this book, this excellent book, Canada and Africa, is that this refugee crisis, in relation to my country, Eritrea, is directly connected to Canada. In Canada, we have, I want to say, in Eritrea, in my country, we have this thing called the National Service Program. And it's pretty much an indefinite military conscription program. Right? People graduate high school, and until they are the age of 50, they are likely, or they could be conscripted into the military. The thing is, we don't have any wars going on, so people are instead, in reality, put to work in various social projects. So they're there from 18 till however long. There are reports of people in indefinite military conscription for over 10 years. In this city, we are a mining capital. I'm going to get to the connection in a second. We are a mining capital. We have something like 800, somewhere between 800 and 1,200 mining exploration firms based in this city for a number of reasons. You know, we've got one of the lowest corporate tax rates in this city. The Harper government is very interested in investing in or subsidizing the mining industry. It brings in a lot of money into this country, into this city. And in this city, we have two companies, one that has been operating in Eritrea for a long time. That's Nevsun Corporation. It's based right downtown. Nevsun Corporation has been accused, with justification, with a lot of evidence, of using those indefinite military conscripts that I was talking about. Those indefinite military conscripts, in that context, that's slave labor. They're working for no pay, or something as little as $3 a month. They are being tortured. They aren't fed well enough. They're malnourished. Poor housing conditions. You know, if they leave, if they try to flee, they are shot, and their families face repercussions. There's something like 600, 700 slave laborers, or as they call them, military conscripts, who have worked on Nevsun's, the Vancouver company's, mining site in Eritrea. This city benefits from the exploitation of slave labor in my country. And many of the people who are leaving Eritrea are leaving because of the reality or the threat of indefinite military conscription. So the country that produces the second or maybe third largest group of refugees crossing and drowning in the Mediterranean is directly influenced by or produced by a Vancouver company. So that's where we're at. And this is, you know, this is the reality of Canada's involvement in Vancouver or in Africa. So as I said, there are two companies. There's Nevsun Resources that has been operating, and there's also Sunridge Gold, which will be operating within the next 6 months. It will be constructing. And it's pretty much inevitable that they will be using slave labor and will be fueling the refugee crisis in Eritrea, and that will inevitably lead to more deaths in the Mediterranean. So that's, as I said, that's the situation. That is my own personal connection with this book. And I think this is a very important time in the context of this ongoing and escalating refugee crisis to really take stock of and really acknowledge the true reality of what Canada is. You know, there's this image of Canada as this benevolent force globally, and that's just simply not true. It's clearly something that this country has created to mask the reality, the brutal reality. So I'm very happy that this book has come out, and I'm very happy that you've written this incredibly detailed historical account. Like, I'm just talking about something that's happening now. You really do a great job of looking at the, you know, this couple hundred years of context here. So on that note, I would like to welcome, and I hope everyone warmly welcomes Yves Engler.
Thanks, Dan. Thanks for that great introduction. So basically, this is a part of a tour for my latest book, Canada and Africa, 300 Years of Aid and Exploitation, which is obviously a historical account. But since we are in the midst of federal election, I think it's appropriate to start with our good friend Stephen and his policy towards the African continent. And Harper has very much made Canadian policy in Africa synonymous with the interests of mining companies. He himself has lobbied on behalf of mining interests in a number of visits he's made to the continent, sometimes quite controversial mining interests in the case of Tanzania, when Harper was lobbying on behalf of Barrick Gold just after Barrick Gold announced it was going to lay off 1,000 striking miners. And Barrick Gold's operations, significant amount of violence it has spurred in Tanzania. Basically, Canadian diplomacy across the continent, the primary thing that Canadian diplomacy does is advance the interests of Canadian mining companies. Canadian aid policy has, the Harper government has put tens and tens of millions of dollars in Canadian aid money into the mining sector and advancing Canadian mining interests. One initiative they launched last year was called the EXCEED, the Extractives Cooperation for Enhanced Economic Development, which the federal government described as, quote, a new funding mechanism to expand Canada's involvement in areas of high development impact in the extractive sector in Africa. $25 million a year initiative. When they talk about high development impacts, this is a Canadian aid agency referring to that, what they mean is taking profits from African resources and paying shareholders in Toronto, Vancouver, and other cities. Part of this aid money has gone to some fairly controversial initiatives, one in Burkina Faso, where a Canadian mining company was brought together with a Canadian NGO, $5.5 million in Canadian aid money, for an NGO project in the community where the mining company is operating. And basically, the objective is to pacify local opposition to IAM Gold's operation in Burkina Faso. The Harper government's also been signing foreign investment promotion protection agreements with, or negotiating with more than 10, somewhere between 10 and 15 African countries. And basically, foreign investment promotion protection agreement gives Canadian companies the ability to sue African governments in an international tribunal for lost profits. Lost profits because a government maybe rescinds a concession, a mining concession, or even if a government brings in domestic procurement rules whereby it mandates a certain amount of products the mining company uses be sourced locally in a bid to generate local employment. That can be rationale for a Canadian company to sue an African government under a FIPA. And these FIPAs are effectively locked in for 16 years. So even if it's an elected government in Cameroon that signs a FIPA today with Ottawa, future governments are locked in, constrained by the accord, and which obviously undermines electoral democracy. But in a particularly egregious example of a FIPA undermining electoral democracy, the Harper government signed a FIPA with the government in Burkina Faso in the spring of this year. That's a government that's a caretaker government that has replaced the Blaise Compaoré regime that was overthrown after 27 years by popular revolt. It's a caretaker government basically preparing the way for elections. Supposed to be preparing the way for elections. And the Harper government signed the FIPA with Burkina Faso regime, locks in future governments for more than a decade and a half. Serious challenge, serious undermining of basics of electoral democracy. And the Harper government's support for the mining sector as kind of alluded to, takes place in the context of incredible number of abuses by Canadian mining companies in Africa. In the book, I have a chapter that's about 12 to 15,000 words of different examples, in a large part, of Canadian mining companies' abuses across the continent. And that's displacing communities, ecological damage, violence engendered by Canadian mining companies. One of the worst examples of the violence is Barrick Gold's mine in Tanzania, which has Barrick Gold security forces and police paid for by Barrick Gold, has led to about 24 people being killed by security forces, Barrick security forces, over the past decade. So a great deal of violence and abuses often engendered by Canadian mining companies. But despite that, the Harper government aggressively backs Canadian mining companies through diplomatic measures, through aid policy, through things like foreign investment promotion protection agreements. There's also, beyond the specific abuses of Canadian mining companies in Africa, there's a bigger question of whether this is a model of economic development that is beneficial to most Africans. Certainly, there are many Africans that benefit from Canadian mining companies. There's the rise of a billionaire class on the continent. But the vast majority of the population, in my opinion, are not benefiting from a model of economic development that the Canadian government is pushing quite aggressively on the continent, Canadian aid ministers, et cetera, whereby the vast majority of profits leave the continent, whereby a great deal of the engineering positions, the management positions, are filled by foreigners, by Canadians, by Americans. Really, the model of African countries depending on foreign companies extracting their natural resources is really the sort of the strengthening of the colonial model, whereby African countries are sources of basic commodities with all the high value added production taking place outside of the continent. Shifting gears from Harper's mining policy on the continent, which has been, I think, their most important element of Canadian policy on the continent, is the mining policy. But shifting gears, the Harper government waged war on Libya in 2011, flagrant violation of international law. There was a Canadian general who oversaw the NATO bombing campaign. There was 7 Canadian fighter jets that were part of it. There were Canadian naval vessels patrolling off the coast of Libya. And this was a violation of international law at a whole series of levels. A number of reports pointed out that Canadian special forces were on the ground in Libya. UN resolution, Security Council resolution 1970 and 1973 explicitly precluded foreign troops from being on Libyan territory. Waterloo-based drone company provided drone to the rebels, with a Canadian former Canadian military man training the rebels in use of the drone. The UN resolution called for an arms embargo of Libya. Montreal-based Garda World, biggest privately held private security company in the world, they were helping the rebels. UN resolutions said no mercenaries, no foreign mercenaries in Libya. So this was taking place in flagrant violation of international law, and for this alone, Harper should be brought to trial, international trial for war crimes. As has kind of been mentioned by, as Dan mentioned a bit, the Libya situation has also greatly destabilized Libya, and Libya has become a major launching point for refugees into Europe. And there was a great deal of violence in the initial campaign, NATO campaign, thousands of people who were probably killed. And there's been thousands, probably tens of thousands more that have died in Libya due to the instability, the destabilization of that country that the NATO war has caused. And I just saw a report saying that more than half of all Libyans have been directly affected by violence over recent years. And so the war in Libya, or on Libya, has been, I think, quite negative for that country and for the region more generally. But I think the war in Libya also has to be seen in a broader context of Canadian-US military policy on the continent. First of all, A number of people have pointed out that Gaddafi was leading the charge. Whatever you want to say with about many elements of the domestic repression, but Gaddafi was leading the charge against the U.S. Africa Command being based on the continent. And the U.S. Africa Command is a regional command of the Pentagon, which has previously been based in Germany with CENTCOM. And the Americans have been trying to push it onto the continent for quite a few years now. So getting rid of Gaddafi seems to have enabled that process. The other part of the military policy in context of the Libya war that's important is Canada's role in supporting African Union forces across the continent. Most obviously in Somalia and in Sudan, tens of millions, probably over $100 million Canadian money going into supporting those missions. But additionally, there's been tens of millions of dollars in Canadian aid money going to supporting the African Union's Africa Standby Force, which has regional components across the continent, I think five or six different regional components. And the African Standby Force, or Canadian support for the African Union Standby Force, is done under the guise of wanting to support African solutions to African problems. That's how Canadian policymakers justify it, which is a very colonial kind of attitude, right? Imagine the ambassadors in Ottawa got together, the Zimbabwean, the Ugandan, and Kenyan ambassador got together and said, hey, you know what? We believe there should be Canadian solutions to Canadian problems. Put out a press release. It's self-evident there should be Canadian solutions to Canadian problems. You only would say that if you're coming from the perspective of controlling a country or place's affairs from the outside. So the rhetoric is African solutions to African problems for why we're supporting different African Union military initiatives. Now, in the case of the war in Libya, there were very clear African solutions to an African problem. The African Union put forward a whole series of different peace proposals, tried to negotiate between Gaddafi and the rebels, to the point where there was heads of state from different African governments that traveled to Libya in the midst of the conflict to try to negotiate a solution. But in that instance, London, Ottawa, Washington weren't interested in African solution to an African problem. When the African solution doesn't serve our geostrategic interests, it's not of interest, to the point where it doesn't even get reported on in our media, despite the fact that there was very aggressive African Union peace proposals with regards to Libya, which makes you wonder, well, what's really the objective of building up African Union Africa Standby Force? And a number of people suggested it's about the Pentagon having military forces on the continent that are financially and logistically dependent upon Washington, Ottawa, to a lesser extent, but in part, to have better control over the continent, militarily speaking. Shifting gears to another area and what probably will be seen as Harper's biggest crime against Africans, which is their complete indifference to the impact of climate change on the continent. And this is not something that's going to be a problem somewhere down the road. Yes, it will become a bigger problem somewhere down the road, but it's already a significant problem. In 2011, there was a major famine in Somalia. British climate scientists connected it directly to climate change. There was tens of thousands of people maybe that had died in that famine. Climate Vulnerability Monitor refers to hundreds of thousands of people dying already because of climate disturbances, a high proportion of those people on the continent, and generally some of the most vulnerable people on the continent. Harper government doesn't care, pulled Canada out of the Kyoto Protocol, undermined international climate negotiation meetings, lobbies on behalf of heavy carbon emitting tar sands interests in the US and in Europe. The Harper government also doesn't care about the fundamental injustice of climate change, whereby African countries emit about 1/100th per capita carbon emissions as Canadians, as in Canada, which means that African governments, African political systems, for the most part, can do fairly little to lessen the damage of climate change that they are bearing the brunt of. But again, the Harper government really just doesn't care, and they don't care to the point where they pulled Canada out of the United Nations Convention to combat desertification in countries seriously affected by drought and or desertification, particularly in Africa. That's the actual name of the UN body, which maybe they could use a PR firm to help them out with a bit. And basically, that's a body that gathers research on desertification, shares research on desertification. Canada is, Harper government made Canada the only country in the world not part of that body, saved Canada about $150,000 a year in doing so, completely irrelevant to the federal government budget, but I think highly symbolic of the Harper government's indifference to the impacts of climate change, their hostility to science around climate change, and their ambivalence to the UN more generally. So Harper is vile for what he's done in Libya, should be brought to international tribunal, maybe for the other policies, you know, a different kind of tribunal. Maybe sometime, other time in the history of humanity, people would have dealt with them differently. But unfortunately, Canada's role in the impoverishment of the continent didn't begin with Stephen Harper and won't end with Stephen Harper, which, though that is a very important first step, I think, in a more justice-oriented Canadian foreign policy. And in the book, I trace Canada's role in the transatlantic slave trade. So there's been most attention around the transatlantic slave trade is focused on the impact on those who were stolen, right? Those who were enslaved. There's been less discussion about the impact on African societies, African nations, the instability that the slave trade brought about, the heightened ethnic conflict, the trading of human beings for guns and the whole, what that meant in terms of engendering war on the continent. And of course, the transatlantic slave trade is part of what weakened African societies, allowing Europeans to colonize the continent in the late 1800s, going from less than 10% European controlled in 1870 to more than 90% by 1914. And so Canada's ties to the transatlantic slave trade are a few. First of all, there were obviously Africans enslaved in this country for more than 200 years. That was legal for more than 200 years. There were Canadians, in quotations, because of course this is before Confederation, 1867. There were Canadians that helped the British suppress the great Haitian slave revolution of 1791 to 1804. The naval base in Halifax was also used significantly in the British suppression of the Haitian slave revolution. Most significantly, the Atlantic provinces generated a great deal of wealth in selling cod to the plantation economies, the slave plantation economies in the Caribbean. And basically, the slave owners in the Caribbean didn't want to devote any of their land to foodstuff for their slaves. They wanted it all for cash crops for export, primarily sugar. But they needed a source of high protein, salty, cheap source of food to keep people working 16 hours a day, to keep the slaves working 16 hours a day. And a big chunk of that food came from Newfoundland and Nova Scotia. And it led to a very significant trade between Halifax primarily and the Caribbean, a trade that generated significant wealth. In the book, I trace it to some of the wealth that set up the CIBC, Scotiabank, to that trade. Some Africans were shipped north in that trade, and it did have quite a bit of economic benefits to Halifax, especially. But this book, more than my previous books, I feel comfortable saying at the end of doing it, more than my previous books, this is really a book about Canadian imperialism. And specifically Canadian imperialism from the late 1800s onwards. And I say I'm comfortable saying this is a book about Canadian imperialism because Canadians and Canada participated at all levels of the imperial colonial project in Africa. The level of the military conquering, the level of the political administration, at the level of economics, and at the level of ideological, cultural penetration through missionaries. In 1885, 385 Canadians were dispatched or went off to Khartoum towards Khartoum.
Read it.
Um, 385 Canadians went to Khartoum to support the British that were under siege to support the British who were under siege in Khartoum from indigenous forces. So British forces, Canadian, 385 Canadians supported the British attempt to maintain control of Khartoum in 1885. Thousands of Canadians fought in the Boer War of 1898 to 1902, where there were thousands of Boer women and children killed, as well as, and much less attention to this, thousands of Africans killed. There were dozens, probably hundreds of Canadians fighting mostly with the British that conquered different parts all throughout the continent, from Kenya to Ghana to Nigeria. Most of those individuals in the late 1800s were trained at the Royal Military College of Canada in Kingston, set up in 1876 as a place to train, in large part to train officers for the British military. And Canadians participated all across the continent. One of the most prominent Royal Military College of Canada trained officers on the continent was a man by the name of William Heinecker, who was part of 12 different expeditions between 1896 and 1907 with the West African Frontier Force, which was the British military force in West Africa. He rose to become a full general within the British military. And Heinecker, in his book and books about him, describes the scorched earth policies that he pursued, describes burning towns. And in his 1906 book, Bush Warfare, which became a training manual for British officers about to depart to Africa, Heinecker explains, quote, "The great thing is to impress savages with the fact that they are the weaker and enforce the will of the white man and accomplish the object for which this expedition is organized. No leniency or half measures are of any use until the savage has felt the power of force. Leniency is treated as a sign of weakness." Here's a sign of that racism, the brutality of Canadian military officer, not only his own attitude, but what he was promoting towards others, or trying to engender in others. Another Canadian, a prominent individual in conquering different parts of the continent, was a man by the name of William Stairs, Halifax, from a very prominent family in Halifax. Participated in two major expeditions, the first one being the Emin Pasha Relief Expedition, which was the first effort by Europeans to cross the center of the continent through the Congo. Became quite an infamous expedition. It took almost 3 years. Stairs participated in that. He was one of 10 Europeans or 10 whites that crossed. He also led a force of nearly 2,000 that conquered the Katanga region of the Congo for King Leopold II, the Belgian king. The Belgian king, who some people may be familiar with Adam Hochschild's book, King Leopold's Ghost, which describes the brutal form of rubber extraction economy that Belgian king brought in, that literally led to millions of people being killed. So Stairs actually added 150,000 square kilometers to King Leopold's so-called Congo Free State. And Stairs, trained at the Royal Military College, one of the first graduates of the Royal Military College, has diaries for both of his expeditions. In those diaries, he describes the ransacking the place. He describes taking slaves. And in one instance, he puts forward this passage, which I think really gets to the inhumaneness of the man. Stairs explains, quote, "It was most interesting lying in the bush and watching the natives quietly at their day's work. Some women were pounding the bark of trees preparatory to making the coarse native cloth used all along this part of the river. Others were making banana flour by pounding up dried bananas. Men we could see building huts and engaged other such work. Boys and girls running about, singing, crying, others playing on a small instrument common all over Africa, a series of wooden strips bent over a bridge and twanged with the usual, twanged with a thumb and forefinger. All was as it was every day until our discharge of bullets, when the usual uproar of screaming of women took place. So here you describe this just incredible inhumanity of what was motivating Stairs. And Stairs, upon his return from this expedition, was feted by the mayor of Halifax. Nova Scotia's Lieutenant Governor General was on hand. They played Here Comes the Conquering Hero. Today at the Royal Military College in Kingston, there's two plaques for William Stairs. There's another plaque at a cathedral in Kingston, and there is an island in Parry Sound, Ontario, named after him. So he's a great great Canadian, despite the fact that his own diary describes all kinds of horrors that he contributed to. And he also, of course, added a significant chunk of territory to European colonial rule. There were Canadians who governed British colonies of Ghana, Kenya, Northern Nigeria. One Royal Military College trained individual, Percy Gerard, was the governor of both Northern Nigeria and Kenya. There were hundreds of Canadians that had lower administrative positions within colonial administrations across the continent. And in 1923, there was an initiative called the Dominion Selection Scheme that was begun by the Colonial Office in London with Ottawa and Canadian universities, University of Toronto, McGill, Queen's, to recruit recent graduates of those universities to join the British colonial administration. And the instigator of the initiative at the Colonial Office in London referred to it as, quote, taking Canada into partnership in the white man's burden. There were towards 2,500 Canadians, missionaries on the continent at the end of the colonial period. First one leaves in 1860. And the Canadian missionaries played a significant role in undermining African cultural ways, in familial customs, economic systems. That's what civilizing was really about. And they also encouraged imperialist sentiment in this country. To fundraise, they needed to denigrate African societies and African ways. That was the way that, I mean, how do you get people to put up money for their mission stations without describing things in a kind of horror-filled way? So they repeatedly referred to the darkness, the heathenism, the nakedness they claimed they saw. And they fortunately, from a standpoint of a researcher, they published a whole bunch of books and pamphlets way back in the late 1800s and early 1900s. And one of the preeminent ideologues of the Sudan Interior Mission, which was set up in Toronto in 1893, it became the largest interdenominational Protestant mission on the continent at the end of the colonial period, about 1,300 missionaries, not all Canadians, but it was still based in Toronto. Douglas C. Percy, leading ideologue of the Sudan Interior Mission, published a handful of novels denigrating Nigerians, current-day Nigerians, and a number of nonfiction books and pamphlets. And in a 1948 supposed nonfiction book, Percy explained, quote, "The people of Africa have associations with demonic powers. Behind the face of Africa looms a dark, evil intelligence, the shadow of Satan, the great enemy of God and man." So that's kind of the ideology they were pumping into Canadian society, and which very much encouraged imperialist sentiment. On the ground, they were undermining African cultural familial ways, oftentimes working with the colonial administrators in doing so. And in the book, I detail some examples where it was Canadian missionaries working with Canadian colonial administrators to undermine African ways, or in this case, Ugandan ways, one example. And to get a sense of how closely the Canadian missionaries worked with the colonial conquering process, in 1890, a Canadian Jesuit headed up a small Jesuit mission post in southern Africa. Alphonse Daigneault was his name. He provided health services to Cecil Rhodes, the famous British imperialist. Cecil Rhodes' organized force that was about to go conquer part of current-day Zimbabwe. And the Canadian Jesuit provided those health services, which was basically recruiting nurses for the Cecil Rhodes' forces, in exchange for a large plot of land in current-day Harare, the capital of Zimbabwe. So they did it partly in exchange for land, and partly because the Ndebele people, which I know I'm mispronouncing their names, they had resisted the missionary incursions. So partly as a way to spread the word of God, Canadian Jesuit was willing to militarily conquer, support military conquering people. In 1893, the Canadian Customs set up a trade return category for, quote, British possessions in Africa. That was then extended in subsequent years to other European colonial possessions in Africa. Canadian trade representative set up in South Africa in 1902, responsible for a number of different British colonies, particularly on the eastern coast. First Canadian mining company, Alcan, begins prospecting in Guinea in 1916, opens a mine in the end of 1920s. Bata Shoes, Toronto-based company, they begin on the continent in the 1930s. By the end of the colonial period, Bata Shoes dominates shoe making and shoe selling in more than a dozen African colonies, both French and British colonies. Throughout the colonial period, Ottawa diplomatically backed European colonialism in Africa. To the extent that between 1950 and 1958, Canada delivered $1.53 billion in NATO Mutual Assistance Program aid, weaponry, to the NATO European, the European NATO powers, primarily Britain, France, Belgium and Portugal. That's about $8 billion today in weaponry. This is not sold, this is given. What were Britain, France, Belgium, Portugal doing in the 1950s in Africa? Anyone?
Putting down rebellions and the nationalism.
Brutally, in many cases. Brutally. So in the case of the British in Kenya, they were suppressing the Mau Mau revolt, where minimum of 10, but probably tens of thousands of people were killed, oftentimes in incredibly horrific ways. Some Canadian weaponry and military support went into that. When the French had more than 100,000, had hundreds of thousands of troops in Algeria, Canada was delivering ammunition to the French, knowing full well where that ammunition was being put to use, and the French were responsible probably for even more deaths, probably 100 plus thousand deaths in Algeria. Similarly, to a slightly lesser extent, with the Belgians in the Congo and the Portuguese in Angola, Mozambique, Guinea-Bissau, throughout the 60s and into the early 70s. And that in that instance, Canada's NATO Mutual Assistance Plan weaponry to Portugal received a little bit more public attention and public criticism. So Canada very much supported European colonial rule in Africa. That's abundantly clear for anyone who bothers to take a look at it. But find me an academic in this country who points that out. I only found one instance in a PhD thesis where they explicitly mention that Canada supported European colonial rule in Africa. And in some instances, they did pretty much all they could to avoid doing so. So in one instance, there's a chapter in a book that traces Canada's diplomatic history in Africa, talks about Canada setting up trade office in South Africa in 1902, and talks about another one in Congo in 48, a whole bunch of things that imply Canadian complicity with European colonial rule, but they never stated explicitly. Yet, I would argue that's a fairly politically salient point. So why don't they state that explicitly? And I think the reason they don't state it explicitly is because today most people who bother to think of these things believe that European colonial rule was wrong. And to state that Canada was complicit in that obviously challenges the myth of benevolent Canadian foreign policy that is very deeply held in our political culture. Liberal scholarship in this country has consciously mythologized the history of Canadian foreign policy. And so liberal academics don't feel it's in their interests to mention the obvious point that Canada was complicit in European colonial rule in Africa. Upon independence, Ottawa's response was, with Ghana in 57 beginning the process, Ottawa's response was to provide aid to African governments if they joined the Commonwealth. And they began the Commonwealth, or the Special Commonwealth Africa Assistance Plan, which provided aid to former British colonies if they joined the Commonwealth. The Commonwealth at that time, of course, was much more British dominated than it is today. It included the European settler states, Canada, Australia, New Zealand, apartheid South Africa. The recently decolonized South Asian states had joined, but it was still very much dominated by London. So the point was to basically provide aid to keep African governments within the Western fold so that they didn't break too far, didn't pursue a radical decolonization. And a big chunk of the initial Canadian aid in Africa went to military training. And in two instances, it was incredibly politicized military training. In the case of Tanzania and in the case of Ghana, it was very much about those countries not trying to stop those countries from breaking, to pursuing a more socialistic path, to going towards China, to going towards the USSR, or really breaking away from European colonial rule. And in the case of Ghana, it was the Canadian-trained military who will overthrow Kwame and Nkrumah, independence leader in 1966. And we have the internal files. So Kwame Nkrumah today is widely revered as a Pan-African figure. He was dubbed Man of the Millennium by BBC listeners in Africa. When Michel Jean was in Ghana, she later, Canada's former governor general, she laid a wreath at his tombstone. So today, positively seen. But at the time, Canada's High Commissioner boasted that Canada's military training had maintained Ghana, in his words, as the most Western, had maintained Ghana's military, in his words, as the most Western, the most Western-oriented institution within the country. And after Kwame Nkrumah was overthrown, Canadian High Commissioner said, quote, in an internal communique to Ottawa, "A wonderful thing has happened for the West in Ghana, and Canada has played a worthy part." Idi Amin, most people familiar with Idi Amin? The last king of Scotland, Forrest Whitaker. Widely reviled today, I think rightfully so, huge number of people responsible, he was responsible for killing a huge number of people. What's not talked about much is that Canada supported Idi Amin's coup against the Milton Obote. Idi Amin had been a British military official in Kenya in terms of suppressing the Mau Mau revolt in Kenya. And obviously London backed Amin's coup, Washington as well was in the background, and Israel. And Canada seems to have supported it as well. Falconbridge, Canadian mining company, had a major mine in the west of Uganda, the Kalembe mine. They weren't happy with Milton Obote for increasing taxes on copper exports. Badashoes wasn't happy with some of the mild nationalist economic policies that Milton Obote was pursuing. And on three occasions in the House of Commons, Trudeau and his foreign minister refused to condemn Idi Amin's coup. And there's a few other examples or documents that sort of hint to Canadian support for the coup. The strongest one being a Canadian International Development Agency worker in Uganda, one of the people on the ground, told a Alberta bureaucrat that was about to go on a Canadian International Development Agency internship told him that Idi Amin, quote, the new in reference to Idi Amin's coup, she said, quote, the new administration favors democracy and Western civilization's democracy, while the former one favored the communists. She's saying a little bit more about Western civilization's democracy than she meant to be saying, maybe. And so I don't want to exaggerate the point, but Canada seems to have supported Idi Amin's coup in Uganda. But Canada's most important contribution to undermining and overthrowing post-independence progressive African leaders was in the case of the Congo with the assassination of Patrice Lumumba. And so upon independence, basically the Belgians, which had quite a brutal rule in the Congo, had almost entirely excluded Congolese from positions of any authority. Basically, the Belgians were prepared to provide political independence, but wanted to maintain control of the vast mineral resources of the east of the Congo. And Lumumba, after his election, it was clear he had a different idea. And Belgians responded by backing a secessionist movement in the east of the country. And Lumumba turned to the UN to protect the territorial integrity of the new country and to protect his government. Washington, unfortunately, saw the UN force in a very different light, and they used the UN force to undermine Lumumba in a whole series of different ways. 1,900 Canadian troops would participate in the UN so-called peacekeeping mission. And they dominated the intelligence gathering positions, so they had a great deal of influence within the UN force. And they used that influence to undermine Lumumba. Privately, John Diefenbaker, prime minister at the time, said that Lumumba was, quote, a major threat to Western interests. The Canadian colonel, the head Canadian military man on the mission, Jean Bartoum, he boasted decades later that he had told Joseph Mobutu where Lumumba was when Lumumba escaped house arrest and was trying to gather his forces to challenge his basically a coup against him. And the Canadian colonel told Mobutu where Lumumba was, told Mobutu that he should dispatch a flight to capture Lumumba. There was a Canadian military officer put on that flight. They capture Lumumba. A couple weeks later, he's dead, and then his body dissolved in acid. So in the case of Lumumba, Canada actually played, a fairly significant role in the undermining and killing, really, of Patrice Lumumba. More recent years, the Canadian government has backed structural adjustment policies across the continent, put tens, probably at least $100 million in Canadian aid money through the World Bank, through the IMF, in supporting structural adjustment programs. Structural adjustment programs are usually about making, reforming countries' economies in the interests of corporations, in the interests of foreign investors, usually privatizing state companies, liberalizing investment rules, lessening labor standards, etc. And alongside the money through the IMF and the World Bank, the Canadian International Development Agency put tens of millions of dollars in terms of backing African structural adjustment programs. And most of that money was provided to African governments that followed the directive of Washington, the Washington institutions, the World Bank, the IMF. But in some instances, at least two cases documented, Canada cut off or reduced aid to African governments that didn't follow orders of the IMF and the World Bank. And in Tanzania and in Zambia in the late 1980s. And in the case of Zambia, it led to the Canada support for a structural adjustment program there, led to a former vice president of the Bank of Canada, Jacques Boussière, being appointed the governor of the Bank of Zambia, the person in charge of monetary policy in Zambia and partly responsible for the structural adjustment program. And an African media outlet at the time referred to it as, quote, a white Canadian who came to de-Zambianize the bank post under controversial circumstances. In more recent decades, Ottawa has continued to support structural adjustment type programs. It's not as aggressive, it's sort of more like structural adjustment light, things like the New Partnership for Africa's Development, which the Chrétien government put $500 million into supporting in 2002, and other types of initiatives that exchange Canadian aid money for policy reforms that invariably are about making African economies better suited to foreign companies. And some of the primary beneficiaries of structural adjustment across the continent have been Canadian mining companies. Canadian mining investment in Africa was about just under $250 million in 1989. By 2011, that had reached over $31 billion. About 150-fold increase, incredible increase in that 22-year period. And that's directly tied to the structural adjustment policies. That's directly tied to privatizing state-owned companies, state-owned mining companies. That's directly tied to rules, liberalizing rules around foreign investment, reducing rules around domestic procurement, reducing royalty rates, et cetera. So Canadian companies have been primary beneficiaries of structural adjustment, Canadian mining companies. Canada is the mining superpower in Africa. Outside of South Africa and pretty much all the major mining countries, Canadian companies dominate. And people often talk about China buying up Africa's resources, but on a per capita basis, Canadian companies are buying up Africa's resources at a much greater rate than Chinese companies. And Canadian government aid money and Canadian companies are involved in rewriting African countries' mining codes. Generally, that leads to mining codes that better serve foreign mining companies. So, moving towards a conclusion, I hope that I've painted a grim picture of Canada's role in Africa. I hope no one was expecting a more grim picture. Because if you are, I can keep going. I got more details from the book. The question becomes, what do you do? If you accept more or less what's been put forward, what do you do? I believe that defeating Harper on October 19th is an important step in having a more just-oriented Canadian foreign policy, or at least a less negative Canadian foreign policy. But that's just one step in a much bigger process. And during Canada's role in the Congo between 1960 and 1964, there's a very good book about Canada's role in the Congo during that period with the assassination of Lumumba. He's got all the internal documents. An academic at Wilfrid Laurier in Waterloo by the name of Kevin Spooner. He points to an internal file that lists Canadian policymakers' top 10 concerns when making policy in the Congo, vis-a-vis the Congo. And he points out that Canadian public opinion is not on the list of top 10 concerns, which is another way of saying that it's an incredibly undemocratic Canadian policy, Canadian foreign policy towards Africa, and specifically in the case of the Congo. Incredibly undemocratic. The population is overwhelmingly shut out of the discussion. Now, popular movements in the 60s and early 70s that challenged Canadian complicity with Portuguese rule in Angola, Mozambique, and Guinea-Bissau, I think democratized Canadian policy a little bit. There was movements in this country challenging Portuguese policy. There was a bigger movement challenging Canada's complicity with apartheid South Africa. Despite what the newspapers told you after Mandela died, Canada did not lead the charge against apartheid South Africa. The independent African countries had been calling for the isolation of apartheid South Africa for more than three decades before Mulroney finally brought in sanctions, which were only partial sanctions. There were people campaigning in this country for decades, standing outside the liquor stores, calling on people not to buy South African wine for decades. Before Mulroney brings in the sanctions, which again were partial sanctions. So those movements challenging Canadian complicity with apartheid South Africa democratized Canadian policy in Africa. Likewise, the movements in more recent years that have challenged Canadian mining abuses across the continent, the diaspora communities that have challenged Canada's support for the U.S. U.S.-Ethiopian invasion of Somalia of 2006, diaspora communities that have challenged Canada's support for Paul Kagame in Rwanda, all those movements have democratized Canadian policy on the continent a little bit. We are a less racist society than we were 50 years ago. We are more internationalist. We have access to information and new means that enable knowing what's going on in the world. But we are still very far from where we need to be. Canadian foreign policy is still very much in the hands of a small few. A recent example, a particularly egregious example of that, the Canadian foreign policy debate 2 weeks ago, the election debate, was put on by Peter Munk, the head of former founder of Barrick Gold, probably the worst abuser of Canadian mining company globally on the continent and more generally. It's his institution, named after him, financed by him, that puts on the foreign policy debate. Of course, Canadian mining policy globally is not part of that discussion. I think an extreme example, a current example of the foreign policy discussion is captured by a very select few. So, a big part of the struggle of moving towards a more just Canadian foreign policy is building the critical consciousness about Canada's role on the continent and more generally, and building the political organizations that will challenge, that will democratize Canadian policy in Africa. And building that movement. This isn't a 1 year thing. This is probably not a decade long thing. This is a major political struggle that we have ahead of ourselves. But I believe it is possible to develop a more justice oriented Canadian foreign policy in Africa. I'll leave it at that. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Yves, for that incredibly wide-ranging exploration of this country's undeniably brutal and exploitative involvement in Africa.